Hello dear students, welcome to Endocrinology again. In this session, we will be dealing with various adrenal disorders. In adrenal disorders, I have divided it into two parts. First is the cortex related disorders and another is the medulla related disorders. Please remember from your anatomy and from your physiology, adrenal cortex is made up of three zones. Those are zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis. So zona glomerulosa, or the outermost layer in the adrenal cortex, gives rise to aldosterone. Zona fasciculata, or the middle layer, gives rise to cortisol, or the glucocorticoid. And the zona reticularis, or the reticular layer in the cortex, it is the layer which produces the androgens. For example, DHEA or testosterone. The adrenal medulla, which comprises of almost 1/10 of the adrenal gland, is responsible for production of various catecholamines. And what are catecholamines? They are the chemicals derived from tyrosine. So tyrosine gives rise to DOPA, then dopamine, noradrenaline, and adrenaline. So predominant secretion of the medulla is adrenaline, and in some quantities also noradrenaline. Adrenal hormone regulation, please remember the three layers are almost independent and their control is also independent. So the aldosterone that is secreted in the outermost layer, the function is salt and water homeostasis. The trigger is hypotension and elevated potassiums. It is regulated by renin and angiotensin mechanism. So renin that is produced in the renal tubules in response to reduced GFR. And this renin further gives rise to angiotensin 2, and angiotensin 2 gives rise to aldosterone. Not directly, but it enhances the aldosterone production in the adrenal cortex. And aldosterone regulates the salt and water in your blood. Its deficiency is Addison's disease, and excess is called as hyperaldosteronism. And if it is due to one single adenoma or unilateral adenoma, it is then called as Gons syndrome. Cortisol, the function is survival, glucose and fat metabolism, and also it plays role in immune regulation. It is under direct control of ACTH, so it comes under the pituitary control. Aldosterone is not under pituitary control. Cortisol is regulated by ACTH and indirectly by stress. Its deficiency gives rise to again Addison's. So in Addison's, you can appreciate you have deficiency of aldosterone as well as cortisol. And the excess cortisol production is what is Cushing's syndrome. Androgen production, the adrenal androgens are the weak androgens. But if they are produced in excess amounts, you can have virilization or the male-like pattern of the hair. So this virilization can be seen in various adrenal virilizing tumors or also in congenital adrenal hyperplasia. The pubic and axillary hair that come during the pubertal process, and also the underarm odor, is due to the adrenal androgens. As the age increases, the adrenal androgens are becoming less in the concentrations, so the underarm odor disappears as the age progresses. Catecholamines give rise to, or they are the response, the catecholamines are responsible for fight and flight response, and they are under the control of sympathetic system. Their deficiency is rare, and the excess catecholamine secretion is seen in pheochromocytoma. How to test for hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis? Please remember, out of these three, aldosterone is not under pituitary control. So even if you have a pituitary lesion, your cortisol will be affected, and androgen secretion may be affected partly, but aldosterone or the mineralocorticoid secretion is not affected in pituitary lesions. Cortisol production is dependent on ACTH. So whenever we have hyper or hyposecretion of adrenal cortisol, we have to test for the HPA axis. And how do we do that? The first step is looking at the AMPM variability in the cortisol level, in short, the diurnal variation. In most of the adrenal disorders, be it Cushing syndrome or Addison's disease, the diurnal variation is lost. Normally at 8 a.m., the cortisol is at its peak because of the high ACTH values in the morning. And in the midnight, particularly around 11 p.m., you have a trough in the cortisol secretion. So this diurnal variation is lost, and this is the first step in Cushing's disease or Cushing's syndrome. ACTH stimulation test, when we have to test for the cortisol production by the adrenal, we can give a synthetic ACTH, which is also called as synaptin, and we see for the adrenal response at 30 or 60 minutes. The normal values are above 550 nanomoles per liter or 18.5 microgram per dL. Serum ACTH levels help us in various adrenal disorders, and they are valuable in diagnosis of Cushing's as well as Addison's. Low ACTH levels are seen in adrenal adenomas and hypopituitarism. Coming to individual lesions, Cushing's syndrome. Cushing's syndrome is the clinical presentation where we have excess of glucocorticoid in the body. This glucocorticoid may be produced endogenously because either a problem in the pituitary or in the adrenal, or more commonly, it may be an exogenous glucocorticoid intake or exogenous supplementation of the glucocorticoids. And common scenario seen in practice is when we have steroid therapy for various reasons such as autoimmune disorders, nephrotic syndrome, and this steroid gives rise to Cushing's syndrome. So the most common cause of Cushing's syndrome is exogenous steroid intake. If you do not find exogenous as an option to your multiple choice question, in adults, the most common cause now is Cushing's disease. So a pituitary tumor, a microadenoma or a macroadenoma, depending on the size. If it's less than 1 centimeter, it's micro. More than 1 centimeter is macroadenoma. So this is giving rise to high levels of ACTH, and the ACTH is now stimulating the adrenals to produce more cortisol. So Cushing's disease or the pituitary ACTH secreting adenoma is the most common cause of endogenous Cushing syndrome. Ectopic ACTH production is a rare cause for Cushing syndrome, and the tumors that give rise to this ACTH are bronchial adenoma, carcinoma, and pancreatic carcinomas. So bronchial, either adenoma, bronchial carcinoma, and pancreatic tumors. So please remember, because these three tumors are often asked with reference to ectopic ACTH. Adrenal lesions or adrenal adenoma, adrenal carcinoma are rare in adulthood. They are more commonly seen in infants and children. If we have an adrenal carcinoma, most of them are producing more than one hormone. So they are mixed hormone producing tumors. So we can have features of Cushing syndrome as well as features of other hormone excess, such as mineralocorticoid and sex steroid excess. So we can have features of virilization along with Cushing syndrome. If you have such features, please suspect adrenal carcinoma. Coming to the clinical features of Cushing syndrome, we have a large list here, and each of the clinical features is worth remembering, because most of the multiple choice questions asked on Cushing syndrome are based on this particular slide. So in habitus, we have moonfacies, buffalo hump, plethoric or the red face, obesity. The obesity seen in Cushing syndrome is usually centripetal. So we have the arms are not obese, but this, there is a central tendency, a central deposition of the fat. Skeleton, we have often short stature and fragility fractures. The fractures in Cushing syndrome are because of the cortisol that is inhibiting the calcium absorption, and also it inhibits the production of active vitamin D. The skin in Cushing syndrome is very thin, papery. We can have acne and hirsutism associated, and the striae that are seen in Cushing syndrome are thick, often more than 1 centimeter in the thickness, and they are seen over the abdomen, over the thighs, and in the axillae. The typical color, the typical description is violaceous, or they are purple colored or violet colored striae. The striae that are seen in simple obesity are usually reddish colored when they are fresh, but they are very thin and they are not as broad as you see in Cushing syndrome, and soon they become whitish in color in simple obesity. In Cushing syndrome, they are violaceous, thick, and more than 1 centimeter in the dimension. You can have associated psychosis and proximal myopathy. So they often find it difficult to climb the stairs, and it is the proximal myopathy, not distal myopathy. We can have GI ulcers, reduced calcium absorption. The kidneys may lose calcium, and there may be associated hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis. Most of them have associated hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and females can have oligoamenorrhea. Many of the multiple choice questions have asked this fact, that they're not menometrorrhagia, but oligoamenorrhea is seen in Cushing syndrome. Pigmentation over the knuckles, over the gums, and over the scars is seen in Cushing syndrome if it is central in origin. So ACTH, high ACTH, gives rise to the pigmentation. Diagnostic approach, we have to ask for the history of exogenous steroid consumption. If it is not there, a simple 8 AM cortisol may help us in differentiating between exogenous and endogenous. In exogenous Cushing's, 8 AM cortisol will be suppressed, and in endogenous Cushing's, it will be elevated. So this is the first step. Second step is to see for the diurnal variation. It is lost in cases of Cushing syndrome. We may go for urinary free cortisol. So we may measure the cortisol levels in the urine, and they are elevated. Salivary cortisol is also another option, but it is not readily available. Dexamethasone suppression test, favorite for multiple choice questions. So we have overnight ONDST, low dose and high dose DEXA suppression test. So the purpose of doing three tests is different. Overnight DEXA is a screening test. Low dose dexamethasone suppression test is a confirmatory test for Cushing's syndrome. So by doing overnight DEXA suppression test, we are just screening the patient, while low dose DEXA suppression, where we give dexamethasone for 48 hours and then we measure the cortisol levels in the morning. They are suppressed in normal individuals, but they are unsuppressed in the case of Cushing syndrome. In high dose dexamethasone suppression test, we are basically trying to differentiate between the pituitary and the adrenal causes for Cushing syndrome. So in cases of pituitary high ACTH, if we give high amounts of DEXA, the pituitary gets suppressed. But if we have an adrenal tumor that is autonomous and that is independent of ACTH, no matter how large doses of DEXA we give, the adrenal is not going to get suppressed. So high dose DEXA suppression test to differentiate between the pituitary and the adrenal causes. ACTH levels, we have already seen, they are elevated in central, that is Cushing's disease, and ectopic ACTH production. MRI helps us in localization of the tumor. The treatment is supportive, where we have to control the blood pressure, sugars, we have to supplement with calcium and vitamin D. Surgical removal of the pituitary or adrenal tumor is the mainstay treatment, but till the time we are planning for the surgery, one may start on ketoconazole, which antagonizes the steroid and brings down the steroid production. So medical therapy of Cushing syndrome consists of ketoconazole. Mitotane is another drug. It is a chemotherapeutic drug. It basically destroys the adrenal cells, thereby reduces the cortisol production. Nelson syndrome is seen in bilateral adrenalectomy, where we have already removed the adrenals for some purpose, and now the pituitary is producing excessive ACTH if we have not replaced the patients with steroid. Coming to Addison's disease is exactly opposite of Cushing syndrome. So here we have hypoproduction of cortisol and associated hypoproduction of mineralocorticoid as well. So the disease is basically in the adrenal glands. It is different from the secondary adrenal insufficiency, where we have ACTH deficiency and cortisol deficiency, but the mineralocorticoid, which comes under the renin-angiotensin mechanism. So in ACTH deficiency, that is the secondary adrenal insufficiency, aldosterone production will be normal. The causes for Addison's disease in developing countries like India, the most common causes are infectious, and tuberculosis is the main cause. Meningococcal sepsis, histoplasmosis also important to remember. Autoimmune, we have already seen isolated or autoimmune polyendocrinopathy syndrome 1 and 2, we have Addison's disease. Genetic syndromes like adrenoleukodystrophy and AAA syndrome are the important causes to remember as far as multiple choice questions are concerned. The features are divided into glucocorticoid deficiency, mineralocorticoid deficiency, and androgen deficiency. So in glucocorticoid deficiency, we have fasting hypoglycemia, increased insulin sensitivity, decrease in gastric acidity, nausea, vomiting, and fatigue. In mineralocorticoid deficiency, we have features of hyperkalemia and hyponatremia. So muscle weakness, weight loss, dehydration, nausea, vomiting, hypotension, and some of the Addison's may come for the first time with shock. In females particularly, Addison's disease has associated decrease in the libido, because in males the testes are producing enough of testosterone, but in females the adrenal androgen DHEAS or DHEA gives rise to the libido. So females may complain of reduced libido, decrease in pubic hair and axillary hair. The hyperpigmentation is because of high ACTH levels. Lab diagnosis, exactly opposite of Cushing's. Here we have low 8-AM cortisol. The ACTH is elevated as a feedback from the low cortisol. Because of the feedback from the low cortisol, plasma renin activity is again elevated as a feedback from the low aldosterone levels. So high ACTH in Cushing's disease is the cause, and high ACTH in Addison's is the effect of the adrenal pathology. Hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, hypoglycemia, metabolic acidosis, and if we have facilities for antibody titers, anti-21-hydroxylase antibodies and autoadrenal antibodies are the two antibodies that are seen in Addison's. AAA syndrome, or also called as Algroof syndrome, is the combination of achalasia, difficulty in swallowing, alacrimia, absent tears, and associated Addison's, so AAA. And if we have a combination of X-linked leukodystrophy along with Addison's, so male affection and associated Addison's, we have the diagnosis of adrenoleukodystrophy. The treatment of Addison's is the replacement of glucocorticoid with dexa or prednisolone. If the patient is in the growth phase, one may choose to give hydrocortisone instead of dexa or predni, mineralocorticoid replacement with fludrocortisone, and DHEA supplementation for loss of libido. One has to compensate for the stresses of infection, surgery, or even pregnancy. So in cases of such stressful situations, one has to hike the doses of cortisol or the dexamethasone. Coming to hyperaldosteronism, it is the excess production of mineral corticoids due to the adenoma or hyperplasia of the adrenal cortex. So here we have excess production of the mineralocorticoid, and the mineralocorticoid, as you know, control the sodium, potassium, and blood volume. So you can remember what will happen to the blood picture. If mineralocorticoids are in excess, we will have increase in the plasma volume, we will have hypernatremia, and potassium will be lost in the urine, so hypokalemia. So the symptoms are because of aldosterone excess and not glucocorticoid or testosterone excess, because aldosterone pathway is not under ACTH control. The most common cause for hyperaldosteronism is bilateral idiopathic hyperplasia, that is seen in 60% of the cases, and it has been asked in some of the multiple choice questions. So bilateral hyperplasia, most common cause. Unilateral adenoma, also called as Kahn's syndrome, is the second most common cause. The clinical features are because of the hypokalemia, where the patient can present with periodic paralysis, hypokalemic paralysis, muscle cramps, polyuria, and polydipsia. Please don't confuse this with diabetes insipidus or diabetes mellitus. Prolonged hypokalemia can give rise to polyuria and polydipsia because the concentrating capacity of the urine requires normal potassium. Hypertension is usually moderate to severe, but edema is not present in cases of hyperaldosteronism because there is escape phenomenon. if we have prolonged or sustained hyperaldosteronism, there is an escape phenomenon where the body can lose the excess of fluid. So there is no edema. Please remember, no edema in hyperaldosteronism. Laboratory evaluation shows metabolic alkalosis, low renin, high aldosterone. So in short, we have elevated aldosterone to renin ratio. If I have to name a few high renin and low renin causes of hypertension, in cases of bilateral or unilateral renal artery stenosis, the flow towards the kidneys is hampered. So we have a high renin hypertension. And here we have independent or renin independent aldosterone production. So high aldosterone. So we have negative feedback on the renin. So renin is low, aldosterone is high in cases of primary hyperaldosteronism. Coming to the last entity, pheochromocytoma. Pheochromocytoma is, now we are talking about the medulla of the adrenal. So pheochromocytoma is the catecholamine secreting tumor that arises from the adrenal gland. If it arises from the sympathetic ganglia, it is called as paraganglioma. So pheochromocytoma and paraganglioma, clinically they are the same entities. The cause, if it is in the adrenal, it is labeled as pheochromocytoma. And if it is in the sympathetic chain or the sympathetic ganglia, it is called as paraganglioma. The famous rule of 10%, the 10% of pheochromocytomas are extra-adrenal, 10% occur in children, 10% are bilateral, 10% of the total are malignant, and 10% tend to recur. Pheochromocytomas often have genetic associations, and especially if they are present in the young age, more likely that they are genetic in origin. The disorders that are associated with pheochromocytoma are MEN2 syndrome, neurofibromatosis type 1, von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, and SDH. So these four genetic mutations are associated with pheochromocytoma. The clinical features, the typical triad of pheochromocytoma is headaches, sweating, and palpitation. So any patient comes with episodic palpitation, sweating, headache, please think of pheochromocytoma. They can also have associated anxiety, dyspnea, chest pains. The hypertension is labile or episodic, and one may present with postural hypotension also. So it's not necessary that every pheochromocytoma would come to you with hypertension. Some of them can also have postural hypotension. In a typical paroxysm or a typical episode, is characterized by paleness over the face, cold extremities, and when the episode ends, they have fever and flushing associated with sweating. If the pheochromocytoma is, or if the paraganglioma is situated in the bladder, they can also have painless hematuria. In cases of sustained or prolonged hypertension, one may have end organ damage like retinopathy, nephropathy, and cardiomyopathy. Pheochromocytoma is diagnosed based on the 24-hour urinary metanephrine and normetanephrine levels. So what are these metanephrines? These are the products or the waste products generated by the metabolism of adrenaline and noradrenaline. So adrenaline is metabolized into metanephrine and noradrenaline is metabolized into normetanephrine. And these are normally secreted in the urine and can be measured. So elevated urinary metanephrine and normetanephrine level beyond a certain cutoff gives you the diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. Urinary VMA levels, which were preferred for the diagnosis, are no longer utilized because the sensitivity and specificity of VMA levels is much less as compared to metanephrines. So if you have various options and you are asked for the best sensitivity specificity or the best choice for diagnosing pheochromocytoma, please choose urinary metanephrines and not VMA levels. The localization is done by CT contrast or MRI, and MIBG scan, iodine-123 labeled MIBG, is used for assessment of bilaterality and extra adrenal involvement. Please remember, younger the patient, it is more likely that it is bilateral, it is more likely that it is extra adrenal. So in cases of young, familial cases of pheochromocytoma, please go for MIBG scan and ascertain that you are not dealing with multifocal pheochromocytoma. Because what will happen if we do not perform an MIBG scan and if we find an adrenal focus, we would go in and remove the tumor partly, and if it is bilateral, we are likely to keep some part of the tumor inside. So young patient and familial cases of pheochromocytoma, please perform MIBG scan. Treatment of pheochromocytoma is surgery, but before we go for the surgery, we have to achieve alpha and beta blockade and volume replenishment. So what will happen if we perform the surgery without this blockade? The tumor is rich in catecholamines, and often when the tumor is resected, there is a lot of handling of the tumor, and all the catecholamines get secreted or get excreted in the blood, and intra-op the patient can have cardiac arrest and malignant hypertension. So to avoid this morbidity and mortality during the operative period, we have to achieve alpha and beta blockade. So the alpha blockade is achieved by giving either phenoxybenzamine, which is a non-selective alpha blocker, or phentolamine. So these cause the relaxation of the vessels and control the blood pressure. After giving alpha blocker, we also have to give additional fluid and additional salt, because they are volume depleted, and as the vessels dilate, we have to supplement with water and salt. So this is one cause for hypertension where we give extra salt. Once the alpha blockade is achieved, we add the beta blockers, which take care of the arrhythmias and tachycardia. And the surgery is the mainstay treatment for blockade. If we are performing a bilateral pheochromocytoma surgery, both the adrenals need to be removed, and such patients would require lifelong steroid therapy. So bilateral surgery requires lifelong steroid replacement.